boners. We have to talk about boners.
The wrestling life.
Hey everybody, it's The Wrestling Life. It's episode 262. That's a lot of episodes. It is Friday, March 26th of 2021. I'm Ethan.
And I'm Liam.
Liam, we have so much to talk about this week.
And as always, so many things we can't talk about right here on the first and the only wrestling podcast.
That's right. We are full-blown on the roll, on the road. Rolling on the road, on a roll on the road to WrestleMania. Whee! There's a Fastlane show this past weekend that featured Randy Orton versus Alexa Bliss. Let's just talk about boners right now, all right? That match, Randy Orton versus Alexa Bliss, where Alexa Bliss straddles Randy Orton for the pin. I would just like to go on record, as I believe I'm already on record, as saying that Alexa Bliss is too young looking for me to find attractive personally. But I feel like sometimes if someone were to just sit on your lap involuntarily, maybe something would happen. And that is the first time I've ever watched a wrestling match where I've wondered, huh, I wonder if Randy Orton has a boner right now. And they obviously prepared for that possibility by having her gear cover his gear. So great boners in wrestling history. You pointed some out to me that I had no idea occurred.
Yeah, there's a couple mostly involving John Cena, as it turns out. There's one where during a random like mixed tag on a Raw in Toronto, like the week of a Christmas, they have Trish come back as a big surprise to team with Cena in the main event against Santino Marella and Beth Phoenix.
Great surprise.
Yes, it's a good, it's a fun, it's a perfect like holiday Raw main event.
Yes.
And during that match, very visibly, Cena is pitching a tent, to say the least. I don't know, that's one of the ones I don't know what happened. It just and then someone else pointed out to me while I was doing research that there was apparently John Cena also was very excitable during the Undertaker squash match that he got at WrestleMania a couple of years ago. So it does happen. It's an involuntary bodily function,
right?
Where you're taught about it in health class. Of course, you're homeschooled with Christian parents, and it's a completely natural thing. Things happen. I'm not saying any of these people are perverts. It's just, it would not be the first time that someone had a accident, so to speak, in the wrestling ring.
Someone pointed out one time that Lex Luger was famous for, after he would hit a move, every move he would touch himself. And once you see that, you really can't unsee it, and it kind of ruins every Lex Luger match forever. But yeah, it's kind of amazing that there aren't more boners in wrestling.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really interesting topic. I had not thought about that until you brought it up off air, and I immediately was reminded of having seen like a semi-viral wrestling Twitter tweet from a couple of years ago of someone, one of those guys who goes back and like rewatches every show from a year, pointing out that John Cena was just fully at attention, so to speak.
Yeah.
As he was giving as he was giving someone the five knuckle shuffle.
I don't know how I had never heard of that before, given I'm one of the probably five biggest Trish Stratus fans in the Western Hemisphere. And I've watched that match, or at least parts of that match, I don't know, 400 times. Mm-hmm. And I can't, anyway. The rest of the Fastlane show, apparently there was a real good main event, Daniel Bryan and Roman Reigns. I just kind of zoned out during that match. If you say it was great, I'll take your word for it. But they lost me with the earlier stuff. So,
yeah, I think that's fair. I think it was very good. I would not say it was great. I don't think I will remember it by this time next week. Good match. Daniel Bryan, Roman Reigns, both very good wrestlers. They worked an interesting match. It was, you know, it was the big strong guy, the big strong bully fighting, but they didn't, it wasn't just Daniel Bryan selling the whole time. They put over how like much better of a technical wrestler he is than Roman, and he keeps trapping Roman in different submissions and stuff. Part of the problem is, and it's the problem, this is a wrestling wide problem. It's not, I don't even know if it's a problem. It's just the way wrestling is. When you do the special enforcer or the special ref thing, everyone knows that the match can't end until you do the spot with the special ref.
Right.
So it's like they're doing like legitimate near falls, and you know, Brian's got him in the yes lock, and Roman's in the middle of the ring, and they're like, oh my gosh, is Roman gonna tap out? But then they cut to Edge, and I'm like, oh, right, there's no, you know, even if I thought Roman Reigns was going to tap out clean and Daniel Bryan was going to win the title on the show, once I am standing there, I'm like, oh, well, then I can just kind of check out until they do that stuff. And as far as, like, it seems like they're doing a three-way at WrestleMania with those guys.
Yeah.
As far as setting that up, it was good. Like, I don't know. Like, everyone was saying, oh, this is a heel turn for Edge. I think, I don't know that it is.
It felt like you could play it either way.
Yes. And they might be waiting to kind of see how live fans treat him at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
To make that full decision. But, yeah. which I think is fine. But I thought, as far as, okay, whatever you think of the Roman Edge build so far, or if you're like me and you would have just preferred to see Daniel Bryan and Roman Reigns wrestle in a singles match at WrestleMania, if you accept that this is where we are, that's where we're going, I think they did a good job getting there, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. And Drew McIntyre and Sheamus, these guys just beat the hell out of each other. Can you imagine beating the hell out of somebody and getting the hell beaten out of you in front of zero people? Like...
I mean, pretty wild.
I mean, it's happened to me before, but like, for I don't know, man. Like, those guys work really hard. I'll give them a lot of credit. I just, poor Sheamus, man. Like, that guy's hurt so many guys over the years that I shouldn't have a lot of sympathy for him. But he on this run, he just has a lot of hard hitting matches, and he works really, really hard. And it's all in front of zero people.
Yeah, I mean, I think Sheamus has been, for the last like 6 months to a year, has been the guy who gets the babyface ready for his next guy.
Yeah, and that's a fine role.
Absolutely, I agree. Thought he did a great job with Big E. They had some great hard-hitting matches in the early winter on SmackDown. They moved him over to Raw. And he, you know, him and Drew now have had a couple of very strong, hard hitting matches on TV. I hats off to the guy. I'm sure, you know. And then he hit Matt Riddle in the gut with the scooter. I like that. Yeah. There is something where, like, Sheamus has hurt a lot of guys and hits people too hard in unsafe places. And you're right that, like, he doesn't really. I wouldn't say I feel sympathy for him when he's sort of aimless, like he maybe sort of has been.
Right.
But at the same time, there is something where I'm like, this guy does like work really hard. And if I do think if you're a type of guy who hits that hard, you better be willing to take shots too. And he very clearly is.
Yeah.
And so, like, again, I'm not letting him off the hook for being unsafe, but like, that's, at least, you know, he's getting as good as he gives a lot of times, especially when he's in there with somebody like Drew.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. So I got so into talking about boners that we didn't really talk about the Fiend coming back and Randy and Bray Wyatt now having the opportunity to have two historically bad WrestleMania matches together.
There's no one, right? Has had two terrible WrestleMania matches with the same person.
I can't think. None are jumping to mind. I mean, Kane and Taker's first one. Actually, both of them were like 2.5 star matches. Like they had one. Right. They had one at 14 or 15, and they or had to be 14, and then they had one at 20. And they're both fine.
Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking like really stinking the joint out. Like Brock and Goldberg redeemed themselves.
Yeah.
After they had a terrible match. Yeah. Trying to think of like, I mean, you also, then it's like, you're going down the list of all of like the Mania rematches, like Hogan and Andre, their rematch was like 5 minutes and ended when they hit each other with chairs.
Right.
So you can't really say, and obviously the first match is iconic just for the finish. So
it's iconic. Really, like, of course it's technically a terrible match, but right, it absolutely delivered what it was supposed to.
Absolutely. So I wouldn't call either of those a bad match. Right. And then you just got like Austin and Rock, like set at least 17. And I like the 19 match. I know it's just a lot of them hitting each other with each other's finishers and their own finishers, but
I thought it was great.
Yeah. I like that match a lot. So yeah, I like there's only so many people who have wrestled each other at multiple Manias.
Right.
And then within that subsection have had like maybe one bad match, but not like Hunter and Taker wrestled each other 3 times at WrestleMania and they were all pretty darn good. So
yeah,
I'm thinking at least on this WrestleMania stage, plenty of people have had multiple bad matches with each other, but how many get the chance to stink the joint out, you know, twice in a 3 or 4 year period here?
I really hope people just laugh this stuff out of the building at WrestleMania. Like, I feel like that's the only way Vince is going to get the message that this isn't good. Who is this for? this isn't working on any level except in the so bad it's funny level.
Yeah, I know ratings don't matter because they make so much money and they're a content farm now.
Right.
But like, then like be make the content more boring.
Right.
Like I would rather just like long wrestling matches than this Fiend stuff. Or, and I've said this before, if you're going to do the Lucha Underground stuff and you're going to have zombies and demons and stuff, the whole show has to be like that. I can't handle going from that to a Daniel Bryan match on the same show. Like, it's just not, right. It does not work for me.
Yeah, it's a really stark contrast to, like, I don't know that this Bobby Lashley, Drew McIntyre feud, it's like 5, 10, 15 years ago, I'd be like, yeah, this is not a very good version of serious sports build or whatever. But we've been so long without anything resembling that, that it's like, man, this is great by comparison. But whatever that you think of the Drew Bobby stuff, it's at least grounded in reality. And then the show closes with the spooky Bray Wyatt sound playing endlessly. Like, that is enough to give me a migraine anyway. And it's, to your point, it's, we go from serious sports build and the top angle to supernatural hocus pocus and the other top angle.
Yes. Although, speaking of so bad it's funny, Braun Strowman has a little choo-choo noise when he does his little run around the ring now.
Yes.
I like that. I've been brainstorming more sound effects that they can give guys.
All right. I like
to hear it. When Jeff Hardy does the Swanton Bomb, you just have the sound of like a nuke dropping and blowing up. No brainer. Obviously, it's the Swanton Bomb. Ricochet does a flip. This is, you know, imagine an a time where Ricochet would be on Raw. You know, just use your imagination. He does a flip. So you get like cartoon boing, boing every time he does a flip. That's, you know, no brainer there.
Yeah, that's good.
I had another one that I can't think of at the moment.
All right.
But like yeah, those are my two big brainstorms. Was there should be boing sound effects when guys do flips, and Jeff Hardy should have the sound of a bomb dropping.
I like it. I really like the Braun Strowman train sound, and I'm not even being facetious or sarcastic in any way. Like, of course it's stupid and I would never do it in a million years, but it is hilarious.
But also, like, it's one of those things where, like, if they do this enough and it becomes something of a meme, you can eventually cut out the noise, and then when you have fans back, just they'll all go choo-choo because fans love sing-along stuff.
Yes.
Like, so this could, like, actually work and, like, give Braun, like, another little, like, sing-along thing for the crowd to get into his matches on when he's doing his, when he's doing his little run around the ring.
It's great. He's not... He and Shane McMahon are having a feud. Like, it's the dumbing down of WWE storytelling is... It's... Like, you watch the Broken Skull sessions with Steve Austin and Randy Orton that was on after the pay-per-view. And you're like,
I have not seen it yet, but
can you imagine Steve Austin being involved in a storyline where the entire thing is someone is calling him stupid? It's like, yeah. Steve Austin would verbally slice and dice that other person so quickly. It would be like, what are we even feuding over? And yet Shane McMahon and Braun Strowman are having like this 6-week WrestleMania feud based around Shane calling Braun stupid. What?
Well, and this actually, this is something I thought about that I did want to mention this week, because Paul White was on like 3 different podcasts in the last week, and I listened to about 15 minutes of 2 of them, I think. And during that time, he mentioned like his own creative frustrations and feeling like, you know, there's a certain ceiling for giants in the company, which I know is funny to say because of ceiling is being a pushed character on television for 20 years. But he talked about like, basically he talked about never being given the opportunity to be a top guy. Like you're the, like you work with all these other guys because you're always over, right? And you're never really. And that was sort of a source. He pointed out himself and Kane as examples of guys who were super over and never, but were never really given the ball and given a chance to be more than just the guy who worked with the guy. I found it interesting because we've talked about that 1,000 times on this show. They would not do this with Steve Austin, but they will do this for the rest of Braun's career because Braun is the giant. Right. And that's what you do with the giant. You call him dumb. And right now he's a babyface, so he gets called dumb and gets outsmarted and embarrassed by the heel over and over again. And then in a normal company, you'd be like, well, at least at the end, the heel will take like a righteous beating and the giant will get his revenge. That'll probably happen, but like I can't guarantee that because it's WWE. But
and because the heel is Shane McMahon,
right? And long term, Shane McMahon's probably going to be on television longer than Braun Strowman is. Even from this point to the end of both of their careers, Shane will probably still be on Raw long after Braun is retired or too beat up to go or whatever.
Right. Do you like the Drew Bobby stuff? We touched on it for a second, but do you like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's fine. Like, it doesn't, it's not lighting my world on fire, but to your point, it's simple. It feels like the two top guys, the two toughest, baddest dudes on your show are wrestling for the world championship, and that's all right, man. Like, I have said it before. I like Bobby Lashley in this role. I think he's got a great mouthpiece with MVP. That whole Hort business act is great. Drew McIntyre, not a favorite, but has certainly improved and is a likable, fine, serviceable top babyface.
Sure.
I don't know. I don't really have a sense. Do you have a sense yet? Do you feel like we're just giving the belt back to Drew? Are we re-coronating Drew this year because we have fans and we need to re-coronate him in front of the fans? Or are we giving Bobby a longer run?
I thought the idea was to do as you said and reincarnate Drew in front of people. Then Bobby gets like a 5-week title run or whatever. So also, you know, Vince could wake up on the wrong side of the bed the day of the show and change his mind. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter. But I thought the whole purpose was Drew, but I guess time will tell. Rhea Ripley debuted. Redebuted on Raw this week. She's going to wrestle Asuka for the Raw Women's title at Mania. Charlotte might be added to the match. Charlotte has COVID. Wish her the best.
Yeah.
One night in, they haven't screwed up Rhea yet.
I mean, give it time. I do not see Vince McMahon getting Rhea Ripley in the same way that he did not get Shayna Baszler.
Right.
So I could very easily see, if Charlotte's added to the match, I could see Charlotte winning that match.
Sure.
If Charlotte is not out of the match, I could see Asuka winning it clean. But yeah, like I think she was done in NXT. Everyone there has done all they can do, but most of them aren't allowed to be called up anyway. Right. But she especially, like, she had been the champ, she had been a heel, she had been a babyface, she'd been the champion. She'd done like 3 War Games matches. Like, there really wasn't much. Like, they almost had nothing for her on television.
Right.
Like, which is a ridiculous thing to think about with someone that young and that talented, but they were just like, they were like out of ideas. So they.
Right.
So yeah, I'm hopeful. It's that both, you know, they did NXT tag titles, and they brought like all of the women out on TV.
All 6 dozen women work.
Yes. There. And I was thinking about, like, okay, it's Candice LeRae and like all these super talent, Mercedes Martinez, who was on Raw for a second in Retribution and then sent back down.
Right.
Yeah. Really, really weird.
No one ever did an investigation. No one ever followed up on it. Just like, yeah, she's not part of the group anymore.
Yeah.
What? No. Why?
Yeah. What happened between like Tuesday and
her and choice, Thursday? Their choice. Right.
Right. But just, yeah, it would be fun to get an answer. Not looking to cause a scandal. Just curious.
Yeah. Yeah.
But anyway, it's like you have all these talented women. You have someone like Aaliyah who has been down there for like 7 years. And you're like, what is there left for this? Like, what are they still teaching her at this stage?
Albert's teaching her how to work.
Right. But it's like you have all of these women. Dakota Kai has been down there for like 8 years. Eventually Tegan Knox will come back. Like all of these people, they have people on the shelf that are going to come back. Ember Moon's down there, like all these people. And meanwhile, Natalya and Tamina are on SmackDown. God bless those women. I thank them for their service. Perhaps they could have a role as the commissioner of the show or the Stooges.
Sure. Adam Pearce's Stooges.
Yes.
Sonya Deville's Stooges.
Exactly. I'm sure we could find a role for them, but it should not be active wrestlers at this stage when you have that many people. And again, if they were plugged into like hot feuds and NXT was really firing on all cylinders, then fine. You wait till they're freed up and then you bring them up. But it's like, you got so much talent just doing nothing. And it's just so frustrating. And again, and it's like, you have women's tag titles that you don't do anything with. It could fill some TV time. If you had those women's tag titles defended on Raw and SmackDown every week and you had 7 or 8 teams, just slap some random women together in teams.
Sure.
And call them up. And then you have Shayna and Nia defend against them on one show or the other or both. And you just get some women on TV. You get them some television time. Until you figure out which, if you actually want to push any of them, and then you pick the one you want to push and you elevate them. Like just variety is the spice of life, as they say.
Sure. Touched on most of the main WrestleMania stuff. Sasha and Bianca fans trending, got that trending on Twitter the other day. They want them to be the main event. I don't like the fans' chances. Like Vince put Sasha and Charlotte on in the main event of Hell in a Cell and booked him to go like 45 minutes that one time, like 4 years ago, 5 years ago. And I don't feel like his faith in Sasha Banks as a main eventer may have ended that night. And then she, you know, she kind of took her ball and went home for a few months. And I think it's forgiven, but not forgotten. And I don't think, particularly on a show with Bobby Lashley and Drew McIntyre, it's like, do you think Vince is going to put Sasha Banks and Bianca Belair in a main event over Bobby Lashley? Like, come on, guys.
He didn't put Sasha and Becky in the main event at that Hell in a Cell show that ended with The Fiend getting disqualified.
Right.
You know, like, right.
And they push Becky as a legitimate main eventer.
Right. Unlike maybe how they've treated Sasha or Bayley or some of the other top women.
Yeah.
Becky was treated like a tippy. And I know you've talked about that, like you can also tell based on like the merchandise that was produced for Becky.
Right.
And stuff like that. And the way she, like her television time slots and stuff, like,
right.
She was treated on a different level compared to almost any other woman yes. in that company ever.
Even above Charlotte, like it took them five years to get to that point, but even above Charlotte.
Agreed. Yeah, I totally agree with that. So I mean, like, I think it would be very nice, and I don't want to sound patronizing because I don't generally have a strong feeling. Like, I don't feel like, I mean, one part of me is like, well, no match that has involved Reginald in the build in the main event of WrestleMania, but
top star of the women's division.
Yes. Top star of the women's division. And as I believe it was Joe Gagne referred to him this week on Twitter, the protagonist of WWE Reginald. I rolled that one.
Joe's a funny guy.
Yeah, anyone on any feud that's involved Reginald should probably not be in the running for main events of your biggest show of the year. But it's also like a two-night show, and so the women should probably main event one of the nights just cause. And like, I don't feel like the build to Bobby and Drew has been so spectacular that it has to main event, other than in, again, as you said, in the old man's mind, this is the chance to really solidified Drew in front of a packed house, right, for the first time. So yeah, I don't know. Like, I think it would be great. I would have no problem with Bianca and Sasha main eventing. I have no problem with Asuka and Rhea main eventing, but I don't think either of those are particularly likely to happen.
Yeah. Yep. No argument. Obviously I have a dog in that fight. I should be,
because you're a big Reginald fan.
Slay me, Reggie. That vignette, I'm going to remember that vignette for a long time. Nia and Shayna took Reggie shopping on SmackDown. It was so great. It was straight out of 1988, and it was amazing.
Yeah, you still, that would be on Superstars. Yes. That would be on Wrestling Challenge. Like, that would, yes, be on that type of show.
Yes.
TNT, Tuesday Night Titans. Like,
yes.
That was tailor-made for one of those shows. Absolutely.
Yes. All right. Any other WWE stuff you want to talk about before we move on to New Japan, AEW, the rest of the world?
I guess we could just quickly mention Andrade did, in fact, get his release.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
With no 90-day no-compete either. So yeah. So our theories at this point would be either somebody said a slur.
Always a chance.
Someone stuck up for him and maybe used their own power and position in the company to get a better deal for him than some others would get.
So my conspiracy theory, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to put this together, but so they pull Charlotte from the WrestleMania poster on like Thursday or Friday.
Right.
He gets released Monday or whatever the day was, and then tweets, hey, and then Charlotte tweets, hey, I've got COVID, I'm home resting or whatever. And then he tweets, hope, you know, you'll be back sooner than later, baby. Hope maybe they'll put you back on the poster. So obviously he's poking fun at the fact that they took her off the poster. My thought was she went to the management, said, look, cut him or I'm going home. And they decided to call her bluff and pulled her from all the Mania advertising and blah, 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 blah. And then eventually they decided that she was more valuable to them than they would be hurt by Andrade going somewhere else. And so they let him go with a non-compete, which nobody gets. He could have been on Dynamite this week. But I thought Charlotte used her influence to get Andrade that release, but I don't know that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we won't know unless one or both of them chooses to tell that story. Going forward here. But yeah, it definitely, based on the suddenness of it and that he got the deal that nobody gets when you want to leave and they don't want you to leave. Not only that he got released at all, but that they didn't even, you know, try to enforce a 90-day no compete was just, wow, that's something out of the ordinary happened here.
And a week after he asked for his release and they denied it.
Right.
Like, right. Some stuff went down in that week, but yeah. So he'll have his choice of wherever he wants to work and pretty much any promotion in the world. But as you kind of intimated offline, boy, it's going to be a bummer when he ends up in just Ring of Honor and CMLL.
Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be kind of a bummer if he ends up with Roosh and Bandido and some of those other great Lucha guys that just kind of hang out in Ring of Honor and then work CMLL the rest of the time.
He told those guys, do not go to WWE.
Yeah. Smart guy.
I mean, it depends what you want. It's what we always say when we talk about WWE. Yes. Depends what you want out of life. Do you want to be rich or do you want to be a working pro wrestler who is creatively satisfied and happy?
Yes. Well, and that, yeah, I remember, like, I think it was around the time that Ricochet got no offense in that Brock Saudi match.
Yeah.
There's a lot of like, this idiot, what was he thinking? What did he think was going to happen? And I was like, well, he's only an idiot. I mean, he is an idiot. The COVID stuff kind of proved that, but like,
yeah.
That he was only an idiot as far as WWE goes if he genuinely thought it was going to go any other way. And that goes for any of those guys, Gargano, Adam Cole, like any of those people that chose and have chosen to stay. You know what you're doing, man. Like, you should have no doubts about what is in all likelihood going to happen if you ever get that call to come up to one of the main shows.
Yep. Will Ospreay won the New Japan Cup this year, and they did a domestic violence angle immediately after he won, where he laid out his girlfriend with a cutter. The crowd was very into Will Ospreay's promo. He was cutting a promo talking about how he's going to go on April 4th to beat Kota Ibushi for the IWGP World Heavyweight Championship. And then just kind of out of nowhere, he hit a cutter on B Priestley. And the crowd, which had been clapping along and very receptive to his promo, there was just stunned silence for the rest of the show. And it was a shock value angle. It didn't work. I would not have done it. Particularly because I think Will Ospreay's going to go on and lose to, not just because the fact that he's going to lose in 10 days, but it's like, if you were going to do a shock value angle, wouldn't you really want to save your one bullet for like something that's really going to get you over long term, rather than Ospreay's going to be going to lose in 10 days and then be pushed down the card. He's going to be their top foreign guy at some point. It's just, it's not there yet. And they're not taking the belt off Kota Ibushi after 3 months. So if you were going to do that angle, wouldn't you do it A, in front of an audience that could make audible noise, shouting or screaming or booing?
Mm-hmm.
B, wouldn't you do it if you were going to go on and win the title? C, why would you do it to begin with? But also, I was not offended by it because I don't get mad at a television show when someone commits an assault on. I don't get mad at the actor when he commits an assault on a television show.
Mm-hmm.
yes, the lines are blurred a little bit because it's wrestling, but also B was a willing participant in this angle. I don't think highly of Will or B as human beings. And so it's like, it's garbage people doing garbage to each other. Who cares? But if you were offended by this, I understand that. Where did you come down on Will Ospreay hitting his girlfriend with a cutter after winning the New Japan Cup?
Just to me, it felt like this is like a 2003 SmackDown angle, like, or a 2007 TNA angle. Like, it's just like, it doesn't, my be all end all of this. And you're right. It's fiction. They're not, it's not real life. She knew she was going to get a cutter at the end of the match. Like, you know, he didn't surprise her with it. but I don't think him hitting his real life girlfriend with a cutter is going to make anyone want to see him wrestle Kota Ibushi anymore.
Right.
However, there are definitely people who will not watch that match now because of that angle. May not be a lot of people, but there are people who that is a, you know, and again, whether or not it's a triggering, you know, as you said, whether it's offended or just like, oh, why are they doing that? I don't need to see that on a wrestling show. And or they already didn't like Will Ospreay, and this just gives them another reason to you know, write him off and not want to watch him wrestle. I'm not, you know, and I think those are all valid.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, it's still going to be a great, it would have been a great match. I still would have thought, as you said, thought lowly of Will Ospreay as a person before this angle. It hasn't changed my opinion of him. Right. I think about him the same way I thought about him before that angle. But yeah, it was just like, why would you do that? It just doesn't feel like it fits in this era of professional wrestling.
Right.
Like, and it just feels antiquated to me. And like, what is the payoff there? Is B gonna manage Ibushi now? And is she gonna get her revenge? Is Ibushi gonna get revenge for her?
I think,
or is that just the end of her in New Japan?
I think B's just going back to stardom full time. Like, she's already
just
working stardom. And, you know, nights where stardom and New Japan ran shows on the same night, she worked for stardom. That was obviously always her first priority, but I think that's just it for her in New Japan, but I guess we'll see.
Yeah. So it's just one of those things where like, I don't know, this didn't add anything, but I think it's very valid and I can totally see and do believe that this will hurt what would have probably been a match a lot of people would have looked forward to, even if, like ourselves, we already thought pretty, you know, didn't think the world of Will Ospreay already. I think there are people who already didn't like him who will see that and be very, very turned off to the point of not watching a match they may have otherwise watched.
Yes. AEW and NXT this week. I did not see NXT. I saw AEW. Hey, we're getting a Cody and Brandy Miz and Mrs. show on TNT.
I find that just fascinating. And again, it's the same thing with, like, you know, NBC Universal giving WWE $1 billion, where you're like, you look at the numbers and like, I guess it's better than whatever else is on the network, but the numbers are not great. But like,
right,
the Turner networks love Cody Rhodes. They can't stop giving that guy television shows. There's going to be another AEW show. There's going to be his reality show. He's on the America's Got Talent ripoff. Like, they love Cody Rhodes. They can't stop putting him on television and paying him to be on television shows on their network. Like,
it's something else.
Love it, love it, love it.
We were having a discussion literally minutes before the trailer for Rhodes to the Top aired during Dynamite this week. And I was saying, you know, Cody is clearly checked out of pro wrestling. Like, I thought he wanted to be Dwayne Johnson, and then he got this horrific neck tattoo, and only Warner Media will give him jobs in entertainment that are not in pro wrestling. No knock on Cody, but it's the truth.
Does Warner Media own Stars? Because his friend Stephen Amell got him on the wrestling show.
I actually don't know the answer to that. But yeah.
But also, like, you know, his very good friend is right. the star of the show.
Right. So, obviously, to me, he's mentally checked out of wrestling. He's doing an angle with friggin' QT Marshall on TV. What does this guy want out of life? And you're like, he wants to run for office someday. It's like, yeah, but that's kind of far. What is he doing? What does he want out of life? Like his career right now. And then like minutes later, that trailer aired. And it's like, oh.
Yeah, he wants to have his own, as you said, the Miz and Mrs. or the Shaq show, or
right.
Yeah, it's his own version of that, and just wants to further the Rhodes family brand, of the Nightmare family.
That's right. Hey, but he is doing a few with QT Marshall on TV.
I just want to go over some things I really like about AEW.
All right.
Because I'm going to get really, really mean in a second. And I'd like to do some sandwich compliments.
Sure.
I really enjoy pretty much everything they do with Hangman, the Dark Order.
Yeah.
Find Hangman intensely relatable as a character. I enjoy, they're all very like fun. They're a fun act on television, and it's fun to see like a good guy and he's got a bunch of friends. Like, it's nice, it's fun. John Silver's really funny, and great. Like, I really like that. All right, now here comes the meat where I get very mean. QT Marshall does not belong on anyone's wrestling show, not even Impact. He cut a very long promo. Meanwhile, like Team Taz, who's doing like a big breakup angle. By the way, there's like three different acts that are breaking up at once on the show. But including like the world champion is doing like the official breakup with the Bucks now. But we're also doing Nightmare Family breakup, and we're doing Team Taz breakup.
Yes.
Team Taz got 30 seconds to further their breakup angle
in a pre-tape, yep,
right, while QT Marshall got a live promo that went like 5 minutes on Dynamite, where he talked about his shoot wife, which even though 2 months ago on television he was in a romantic storyline with Allie/the Bunny that they just dropped 1 week and decided to put her back as the Bunny, and then they had one match on Dynamite to blow that off. And then he's just been, I guess, him and Dustin wrestle on AEW Dark. I don't know. I don't watch the show. I think that's fine. I know he's a trainer. I know, and then he starts talking about, like, you know, taking bumps. And I'm up till 6 a.m. planning out the shows with Tony Khan. I'm sure that's all true. I'm sure he is a very hard worker. But he is a terrible promo. And he is not a good enough wrestler that he deserves to be on television more than lots of other people who got either minimal or no time on AEW television last night. He's so bad. He should never be on anyone's television show. He needs to retire. This Cody match needs to be a retirement match. I hate QT Marshall, and I want him gone.
This
when I'm out of my life,
this all feels I feel strangely detached from this, mainly because I went through all of these emotions 6 to 9 months ago when it was my job to watch AEW Dark every week.
Mm-hmm.
And I went from, oh, QT is really underrated as a worker, to actually maybe I would have him teach people how to lock up and that's about it, to him being a pushed act. And it's like, yeah, this guy is not a prime time wrestler, and here he is getting promo time live on the only thing on TNT last night for about 5 minutes, QT Marshall talking.
it's irresponsible.
The size of the roster they have, all the people they have, like, just
Christian got 30 seconds with Kazarian to set up his first wrestling match in 7 years.
Right.
QT Marshall got 5 minutes live in front of the crowd.
Yep. Damnedest thing, man. Damnedest thing.
And if you're going to do the, you know, a member of the Nightmare Family, I'm sorry, the Nightmare Factory, a division of the Nightmare Family,
ugh,
wants to strike out on their own, pick one of the young guys. I don't even care which one. Pick Big Shoddy Lee, who just had like a big win on television a month ago.
Mm-hmm.
Pick one of Billy Gunn's dickhead sons. I don't care. Like, pick anybody. That is not QT Marshall.
Just drive by on Billy Gunn's kids.
Like, I think, honestly, I think they're kind of entertaining in the front row of Dynamite, but also, like, I would hate, I just get the vibe of, like, I would hate this person if I met them in real life.
Sure.
Like, sure. but, yeah. but, yes, I watched QT Marshall talk for 5 minutes, and then I watched Cody, like, I feel like it would be a generous to say he was quarter-assing his side of that promo, where he comes out with his little headset on because, you know, he's working and he's a busy man. He's producing the show. And then he's like, we'll do an exhibition, but I won't crank the figure four when we wrestle. I'll let you go if I get you in position for Crossroads. And I'm like, what are we doing? Yeah. This is what AEW Dark Elevation should be. You want to do all these weird little things. It's like, you know what? I will say, and this is where the other compliment I will give Dynamite comes in. I was not mad when Brandon Cutler was on this show. You know why? Because he's a perfectly serviceable wrestler, and he was there to take a pin in a six-man with the Bucks, and it made sense that he would be the one teaming with the Bucks because they're estranged from Hitman, from Hangman. Right. And Kenny is a heel, and they actually played off of that at the end when Kenny ran out and said, why the hell didn't you ask me to team with you? Why would you team with this loser, Brandon Cutler? And it's like, well, because Brandon's like their actual friend.
Right.
And of course you have to watch Being the Elite to know that, but like, you know, but like, I'm totally fine with Brandon Cutler being on TV to do a job once in a while. I don't like that. Good for him. Who cares? Right. Like, so I guess that's the silver lining of the QT Marshall thing. I'm fine with Brandon Cutler being on TNT now because I don't think he's going to get 8 minutes of promo time anytime in the foreseeable future. And if I'm wrong, then I will come on this show and admit my wrong thoughts. But like, my goodness, like, if you want to hire your friends and find serviceable roles for them on television, whatever. I don't care. You want to put them on the YouTube shows, knock yourselves out. But you have 2 hours every week on TNT, and you're given that much time to QT Marshall while Taz, while all these like pushed acts that the women's champion was on the show for 8 seconds. Like, at least they gave Dr. Britt a promo. To play off the match last week. But like, again, I didn't hate Dynamite. Had some good wrestling on it. Main event with Darby and John Silver was good. I really liked the opener with Omega and Sydal. So it's like, and that does make a difference. We've talked about that a long time, but like, when you know you're getting some good wrestling on the show, you can overlook a little bit more of the flaws.
Yeah.
But QT Marshall, there's a middle part of every Dynamite where I'm like my head is in my hands and I'm just like, all right, that's generally why I usually watch Dynamite on something of a tape delay so I could fast forward through like the FDR squash and QT. But I stopped and made myself watch the QT Marshall thing because I knew I was going to hate it that much.
I'm not going to go bury it too strongly because I did submit an application to be a part of the Nightmare Family.
You asked for it. Did you get the tracksuit yet?
I've not gotten a tracksuit yet. Cody's sister said she was going to put it to a vote whether or not I would be in the Nightmare Family. And that was like 3 months ago and I haven't heard back. So maybe I should check in on that before Rhodes to the Top airs.
Hey, you can get yourself a recurring role.
Hey, it's the fat neighbor.
Show up and you're like, hey, your sister around? Like, no, she doesn't live here. Ethan, go home.
Okay. Shoes. I'm not wearing shoes.
I don't know. That was my big takeaway, is that like there's plenty of good wrestling on the show that I liked, but all of that was outweighed by watching QT Marshall cut a promo.
The presence of hair plugs. All right. Anything else?
No, I think that that about wraps us up. We've covered quite a bit of ground here in this free-flowing discussion.
We did. I feel like we covered everything we wanted to. We did a good job. Good job by you.
Thank you. Good job by you.
Thank you. Done patting each other on the back. Until next time, I'm Ethan.
And I'm Liam.
And we'll be back soon with more stories from the wrestling life.
Farewell.
Thanks for listening. Don't forget to leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. Now, here are this week's bonus features.
Coke Energy. My favorite beverage.
Oh, all right. I thought.
I love Coke Energy.
You love the energy that Coke gives you. That's what you're saying to me. I do.
It's a wonderful product. I like to drink Coke Energy while I'm watching Xfinity.
You want to throw in a shill for like Amazon or something?
I recently bought, actually, I like the crap on Amazon. my good podcast headphones went up, like, I don't know, 6 weeks ago or whatever. Remember that week that I couldn't hear you and it turns out the problem was my headphones broke?
Yeah. Yes, your headphones were causing you to gaslight me into thinking it was my fault.
Correct. Right. So I bought a pair of so you just Google like best podcast headphones or whatever, and like this Sony pair pops up, and then there's like, oh well, there's this Amazon Basics knockoff version, so that's, you know, and the Sony headphones are $100 and the Amazon pair is $50. So it's like, well, I'll just buy the Amazon pair then. So within like right after whatever the return window would be, 5 weeks or whatever of having them, they got a short in them. And I could only hear out of one ear.
Oh, fine.
So I had to buy the Sony headphones anyway. So screw Amazon.
Bad people.
They really are. They're not family guys.
That's right. All right. They're not good family men.
Right.
Not like Conan O'Brien. Not like Chris Jericho.
By the way, Jericho contract coming up, turns himself babyface. Smart guy.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of wrestling, not in terms of life.
Oh, no. One of the dumbest in the world. But as far as wrestling goes, he's not that dumb when it comes to wrestling stuff.
No.
Other than that he insists on doing that lion salt.
Well, now it's a thing, right? Because
right,
people made fun of him the time he slipped on the lion's hall.
Right. And like, if you look at it, yes, he like the guy was closer to the ropes than the guy usually is, and he didn't get like a running start with it. So like, you can justify it all you want. But also, maybe you just shouldn't be trying to do a backflip off the middle rope anymore, man. Like,
yeah.
If there's even a 1% chance you're going to land on your head in that move, maybe you don't need to do it anymore.
Yeah.
Especially when your finisher is a back elbow now.
Yeah, it doesn't really fit with the rest of anything. he went downhill like really fast.
I was going to say, I think I tweeted or messaged this to you a while ago, but there was that picture of him, Callis, and Omega from the Dome match. And like, even since then, it's ridiculous. Like, his head is so much bigger and redder. And like, I think shaving the beard didn't help. Like, I think facial hair, as a hefty man myself, I can confirm that shaving the beard doesn't help if you're trying to not look like you're like a fat dude.
Sure.
But
man, it's an old trick. Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Just things have escalated quickly, I see.
Yeah. You know, maybe I shouldn't drink Coke Energy right before we start talking for 45 minutes, because it really makes me burp a lot.
Is it? So this is not the Coke coffee, though, right? This is a different product?
Correct. This is a different product. This is Coke Energy. I think it comes in two flavors, regular and black cherry. I much prefer the regular Coke Energy. And it has 113 milligrams caffeine. It's 12 ounces. It comes like in a little Red Bull can. It tastes a lot like Coke and not as much like cough medicine as most energy drinks do. Mm. It's delightful.
That's great. Very.
Glad I've done three Coke Energy commercials. It's really a good use of your time.
Oh no, it's fantastic. I try to keep on keeping on.